I'm Pam Miller. I work at Ecoschools, and it's so great to be able to reach out to you in this way. My colleague Jen Vetter is with us, and she's the one who posts these webinars on the Ecoschools website so that you can see the archived webinars and also get access to other ones as well as all the resources. And then on our OISE team, we have Hillary with us. Elise is not able to join us. It's her wedding anniversary. So this is a collaboration between OISE and TDSB. And today we're so excited to feature five excellent eco teachers who have been embedding ecological literacy into their program and also transitioning and putting that into the virtual world. There's the names of our five teachers that will be sharing today, again, bringing their expertise, how they've managed to transition. And we'll also provide you with more resources for learning and some upcoming webinars. Especially excited to have Linda Nakarato with us, teaching us some OPAL outdoor play and learning techniques on the online webinars. And of course, sustainable happiness is coming back just when we need it around report card writing time. So we'll start off with our land acknowledgement. And this is a new artist for me. And I'm going to turn that over to Hillary to tell me a little bit more about him.
I have to admit, Pam, that Brian Youngin is one of my favorite artists. He's an Indigenous artist from British Columbia. He's actually from the Dunza First Nations community in the northern part of BC. And he uses found materials. I don't know if you can recognize what the found materials are in this case, but they're actually green bins along the top that form this walk-in turtle shell, and then blue bins along the bottom. So I thought this was an appropriate start today for our talk about eco learning.
Oh, that's lovely. I'm definitely going to check him out. So with that eye candy, we acknowledge that we are hosted on the lands of the Mississaugas of the Anishinaabe, the Haudenosaunee Confederacy, and the Wendat. We also recognize the enduring presence of all First Nations, Métis, and Inuit peoples. And we know that we are on Turtle Island, so the theme of turtles is so important. And how better to put the turtle in with some eco paraphernalia like green bins and blue bins. So thank you for choosing that. So as we get started, I think we have Anne first. So Anne is from Gateway Public School, which is really in the heart of Toronto. And you teach full-day kindergarten, so feel free to unmute yourself. And you're going to be telling us a little bit about what you've been doing with your FDA class.
We have eight classrooms, and so we work as a team, and we have a great green space by our school, so we try to get them out. It's part of our planning and part of our day. So it's been a bit of a challenge. So here now, we are trying to draw attention, well, what's outside your window when you do go outside, what's outside? This is from, we have a website, that's how we're doing our learning, and with different theme every week. So this was then about Bee Day, World Bee Day that week. And this was then a short video using early childhood music repertoire, finger play.
This is Ms. Stadelmeyer from room 107. It's a beautiful day today. The flowers are blooming. I don't see the bees, but I'm sure they're around. Let's go and find them. Maybe they're in the beehive. Here's the beehive. Where are the bees? Hiding, hiding, where nobody sees. Watch them come creeping right out of the hive. One, two, three, four, five. Bzzz.
I fell in love with that, just the hand signals and how they would be connected. Keep going. There's another.
Hello, girls and boys. Ms. Stadelmeyer, room 107. So we've been talking about inchworms and what would happen if we could make a bigger inchworm. So we can use different kinds of string, and you can make just string with a knot at each end, like that. You can make a string, maybe put a button at the end so that you can hold at each end easily for measuring. So let's take our measuring string. Let's take it over here to our marsh marigold. Let's see what we've got here in the garden to measure. What I love with the string is that we can also do like this. I've made it half. And I'm wondering if this leaf, the marsh marigold leaf, that's about, a little bit smaller than half of my inchworm string. Now, I could also use the button. I wonder what's smaller and bigger than the button. How about the flower? Look, the flower's bigger than the button. That's right. And let's look over here. Let's look over here to our poppies. Let's find the poppies way over here. And let's measure a poppy leaf. Now, is it longer or shorter than our inchworm string? Almost goes all the way down here, but the poppy leaf goes, stem keeps going right down here. The leaf is longer than my inchworm string. Now, what else is smaller than bigger than the button? This is almost the same size. These are the jewelweed leaves. They're getting big. They're going to grow much bigger. How about our poppy bud? Inside is going to be a beautiful red poppy flower. Let's see. It's almost the same size, doesn't it? What else is in our garden? Let's go down here and let's see. Okay, here are three leaves. One, two, three. And again, if I make half of my string, so the leaf, oh, it's also a little bit, it's almost the same length as half of my inchworm string. And if I go deep down inside, there's the jack in the pulpit flower. Little person inside, let's close the roof over there and leave our jack in the pulpit alone. There we go.
And I'm so impressed with all the diversity you already have in your garden. That's just so lovely. Tell us how you made these.
The first one, I had a bit of help with someone who has an extra software program. The second one I wanted to do with what's on the phone. So it's the iPhone and then the edit functions that you can find on that. And plus there's an option there to put in a text, because I thought, okay, what can I do that's more on my own? And this is also, we're experimenting at our school. How can we connect more personally with our students? So little videos like this, we're hoping this will be a good way to do that. I connected with parents. One parent said her son just loved the beehive video. He would replay it and do the motions with it and just repeat, constant repeat. He loved it. So that, I'm happy about that.
Oh, that's great. Having looked at some of the math concepts for early years and learners, things like bigger and smaller, we take them for granted, but that's something that we need to repeat in so many different contexts, and you've done that so well. Thank you so much, Anne. That's just lovely. Next up, Cynthia teaches grades 6 and 7 at Taylor Creek.
Hi, everybody. So it's kind of funny because when Hillary asked me to come today, I was like, why? I have done nothing intentional in my teaching. This is crisis teaching, people. Like, do they not know there's a pandemic? But then when I actually looked at what my kids are making, from what I'm giving them, I felt like I have a lot to celebrate. So basically what I've learned is that you don't have to be intentional, and that just sharing your passions with your students is actually legitimate teaching. So if you go to the next slide, when we sort of got the news, you know, that April 6th online teaching would commence, I was under the impression that the ministry was coming out with something. And so Minge. So they were like, don't go crazy planning anything specific. Wait till April 6th. So of course, April 6th comes out and it's like, okay, teachers, away you go. So I thought, oh my gosh, what am I going to do? So I found this guy, Chris Woods at Daily STEM, who was posting basically like a choice board, like a menu of different ideas. So I've given my kids about 3 or 4 of these different boards. And then I set up for them a virtual notebook so that they already know the STEM engineering process because we've done lots of activities in class already. They're very familiar with the scientific process. So I basically just wanted them to choose the activities and then show me their understanding of those processes through what they were choosing. So if you go to the next slide, I have provided a link to my actual notebook. So I'm doing this along with them so that I could model what I'm hoping their notebook would become. So in the next slide, I decided one of my STEM projects was gonna be bird watching. So I wanted to see how many non-invasive species of birds I could attract to my feeder. I see tons of sparrows and starlings, but what else is out there? So for the last 2 months, three times a day, I've been recording observations. And then, like I said, on this 16th, which wasn't technically a recording day, but if you go to the next slide, I just had this explosion of birds that I saw. And my husband bought me this spotting scope that I can put my cell phone on. So that's how I took the photos. And then I was able to put those into the Seek app and identify what the birds were. And of course, I'm sharing these updates weekly with my students so they can see the progress that I'm making, which then led to Google Breakout Meet groups where they share their what they're doing in their notebooks with each other. So in the next slide, this is Bilal. I just threw out a STEM challenge. Hey guys, I need some tabletop games for indoor recesses at school when we come back. Make me something from recycled materials. So this, if we click, this is what Bilal did. Idea. But adorable that he's like reused a box and found some bottle caps to make that tic-tac-toe. In his notebook, he actually has the process he went through to create the game. He's also made a change sorter, and here in the next slide, he's also done some chalk activism, which I had my kids do back in September, but I remixed it for April, May, June for them to continue to go out and put environmental messages out around their neighborhood. And in the next slide, I've got some students who painted rocks. So what I love about this is they chose. So I didn't know what was going to interest them per se. So I'm learning a lot about what my students are interested in. And even though they were given activities that didn't necessarily have to do with outdoor education or environmental education, they've all chosen something on their own that's connected or related. And I'm not sure what the next slide is. Oh, and then there's another example. This student made a pencil case that can fit 24 pencils by reusing an old plastic water bottle. That's a bandana scarf material that she had to go with it. So they've just been so amazing at what they've come up with that although I didn't present it to them in the cleanest, most intentional way, I love where they've taken it, where they're going with it, and I know what I would do to make it more intentional going forward, which takes me, I think, to my last slide, which is playing around now with how I present the choices to them for them to select going forward. So I'm making template rooms that Jen's gonna talk more about for all of my different subjects going forward for next year.
Oh, so exciting, Cynthia. It's fun, as you said. I think we all laughed when we said, oh, well, the ministry was going to supply some wonderful things. There was a lot of...
But then I was like, hey, wait a second. You know what? I'm going to do what I want. It's called leverage. What are you going to do? We're in a pandemic. Fire me.
But the truth is, by giving students voice and choice, you've really opened it up for them and allowed them to figure out not only what interests them, which we know increases the engagement, but allowing them to see you learn along with them. And we know what happens when we give each other homework, but that modeling is so neat. And of course, the birds knew that you weren't recording on the one day they all showed up. So I'm really glad you got
that. Exactly.
Yeah. Great. Thanks so much, Cynthia. And so our next presenter is Jen Barron, and Jen comes from York Region. She's teaching grade 2-3 at Lakeside. public school.
Good afternoon, everybody. And Cynthia, that was a perfect segue. I started to see these Bitmoji virtual classrooms and I immediately got interested. So I have a 2-3 homeroom, but I also teach grade 1, 2, 3, and 4 presently at my school as a rotary science teacher. And spring is that time of year where we just want to bust out. We want to get outside. And I'm very fortunate to have a lovely schoolyard to take the students into. And they know that with Miss Barron, we're heading outside. So I immediately wanted to recreate a choice board with outdoor learning. And I can see on the chat, will someone send a list out? And I know that Hillary and Pam, I've given these choice boards to Hillary and Pam. So don't worry, you're going to have access to them with the live link. So what I decided to do was create an outdoor virtual classroom choice board. And with this one, it was geared intentionally to my grade 1 to 4 science students. And one of the things that I find very helpful with these choice boards is that there are a lot of entry points. So with the science curriculum for grade 1, they can do the living things strand. Grade 2, they've got growth and changes in animals. Grade 3, growth and changes in plants. Grade 4, habitats. So a lot, and you could do this with grade 6, biodiversity. So a lot, grade 7, interactions with ecosystems. So a lot of different entry points. So as most of you are familiar, when you click on the image, a link will open up. There's all different kinds of things that you can link into them. You could link a Padlet for student feedback. You can link a Google form. This is our Bird Blitz at home. I have also, if I could just speak to intentionally, virtual field trips. So one of the most useful things that I've found to engage my students at this time of year are free virtual field trips. So within this wonderful wetlands, there are 2 field trips. One is to Y Marsh and the other one is to, I can't exactly remember off the top of my head, I think it's the Cattails with the Blue Pond. But it's a trip to the pond through a conservation authority. So there's all kinds of different things. Now, if you flip to the next one, Hillary, what I also wanted to show is I can take this same background and I can have it as an entry point for grade 7 to 12. So right now, you'll see on the title that this is citizen science and climate action. So whenever you click on, well, clicking on most of the animals, for example, the frog is, if you click on the frog, it's frog watch. Or if you click on the butterfly, it's monarch butterfly watch. There's a pollinator one with the bees, that sort of thing. If you click on the smokestack or the pop can, you'll see that they are, they're sites that help students get empowered with action projects. And when I was in this podcast last week and I was listening to Pam talk about very briefly linking to Ecoschools, I immediately thought, oh, aha, this is a way that we can engage our students in these action projects at home. And then if there are teachers that are still doing Ecoschool certifications, you know, and into September, that this kind of thing can link in those action projects. So again, I just like the choice that students have. And then I always link in a Google form or a Padlet so that I can get feedback from them and have that formative assessment piece. As we know, we're not supposed to be doing summative assessment, but I can get formative assessment back from them. If you flip to the one on camping, I did this one because this time of year I also love to camp, as Hillary knows, and on into the summer. And oh, they just opened up backcountry camping yesterday. Woohoo! But a lot of families may still not be able to go camping and or even feel safe to do so. So this idea of this whole board is around camping at home. And there's all kinds of various links for kids to play games, to watch shows about camping. The tent is how to build a safe blanket fort in your living room. The guitar is campfire songs. There's a s'mores at home recipe from the Food Network. And then of course, some of our favorite characters with the Lorax and Scaredy Squirrel camping. And these are all, I didn't create this content. All of this content is on the internet. So you just put in the link. Now the final slide, Hillary, is a how-to. So this is the how-to that I watched that I found very helpful with a step-by-step for how to create them. It's really not that hard. It's easier than it looks. I can do one now in about half an hour, 15 minutes, half an hour. So I hope you find them useful. I've given Hillary the link, and contact me if you want any more information for how to make them work. Thanks for having me.
Oh, Jen, thank you so much. I love the fact that I can go to all the different links. I just actually found a stink pot turtle shell in my cottage area, and they had never been there before. So I'm doing the citizen science piece of putting that on their citizen science place. So it's so important that the kids feel connected to, and important to what they're doing. And so by making it authentic with the citizen science piece, such a great idea. And I love the bitmojis.
Bitmojis are addictive. That's my only warning. You get started on these things and they become very, very addictive. Okay, thank you.
Great. So right after Jen, we have Tisha Hybeen, and she's at Forest Hill teaching an FDK. We've heard from Tisha before, so this is an update on her wonderful learning.
Hi, I teach FDK, and I am one of the people who's involved in action research with OISE and Ecoschools, and I've been looking at how to connect kids with nature for the last 3 years. When we look at my slides, so the question was, how are things going now, and what would you like people to know? And the three things that I think I really connected to in terms of environmental learning and kindergarten, but could obviously be used in any grade, were themes, understanding by design, so that's backwards planning, and sharing children's work. When I looked at understanding by design, so an example of backwards design is looking at what I wanted the kids to know in kindergarten, thinking about what activities I could plan around environment or nature, and then what the working tasks would be that they would do. So online, for me, that was, what do I want my kids to know? I wanted to offer activities that engage interests, so STEM and loose parts, lots of things that they could do independently, not necessarily with their parents. I wanted it to be achievable at home, considering barriers. So whether they were ELL, what resources they had, how much time parents had to be with them. And I also considered very heavily whether the kids can go inside or outside. So every day I have an option for outside and inside learning. I also provide parents with a weekly outline and daily lesson plans, because I looked at it as, in kindergarten, the parents are the co-creators of teaching and learning. This is an example of a weekly outline that I send out on a Sunday night, or sometimes if I don't get to it, very early Monday morning. So the parents just have an overview of what is available. Self-reg and well-being are also in there. I just deleted them because they didn't fit in my slide, but there's always that piece every day, whether it's yoga or me singing or a poem or a book around self-regulation. So here's some themes we've explored. Birds, spring, birds and insects, water, human body, rainbows. We're on our second week of structures. Next week will be caterpillars and butterflies. We're going to revisit water because we're going to look at things that sink and float and build our own boats. And then in the last 2 weeks, probably summer and seasonal change. So some of the things the kids have started to do is observe and show caring for nature. So this is a little girl. She went outside. She lives in a building and she hadn't participated a lot. And one of the things that she went out and did was she caught this owl in a photo. And after she had that opportunity and saw that and connected with that, I started to receive a lot more work. STEM assignments are given regularly. So this little girl created a bird feeder made out of a toilet paper roll and some sticks, seeds and butter. And I would have given instructions for that. We read Diary of a Worm, and then I asked the kids to do their own diaries. So on your left, you'll see with literacy, this little girl did Diary of a Blue Jay, and that was her example. So that's how I connected our bird learning to literature and literacy. And then numeracy, what I started to do was write addition stories. So I would write a story every day in words, and then ask the kids to draw it and write the numbers for it. So this also helped them with their drawing development, but gave them an authentic reason to work with numbers and to practice printing. So spring and loose parts, portraits and planting. On the left, this is a little guy who used loose parts from his recycling bin to make a spring portrait. I find this one particularly beautiful. on the right-hand side, we had given the kids a STEM activity of taking whatever seeds they could find in their kitchen and planting them with just a little bit of water to see what would happen. And the parents sent me this great collage of what those bean sprouts and lentils turned into. Spring, we also talked about life cycles and literacy. So I had read them some books about life cycles of ladybugs and insects. And this little girl went out with her family to Todd Morden Mills. And with her little camera, she took pictures of the different phases of tadpoles. And then she did some research and presented it to the class about how they went from eggs through their metamorphosis all the way to a full-grown frog. And again, it was an authentic reason to write and to practice printing. One of our studies was around water. It was around the time of World Water when we were looking at that. So one of the things that I do typically on a Monday or a Tuesday is get the kids to mind map what they already know. So this little girl had mind mapped what she knew about water. And then I had read them a book, Water Can Be. And it was this beautiful picture book. And I asked them what water could be in their own words. And this little guy on the right said, water can be to help fish and animals survive. Without water, they would die. So he had made that connection that water is essential for all living things. Also, again, the STEM piece. So every week we have two or three STEM pieces. Sometimes I come up with them. Sometimes the ECE comes up with them. The one on your left is called Walking Water, and you do it with food color, just red, blue, and yellow. So it also becomes an art project. And the colors mix, and it shows capillary action as the water changes from glass to glass. And on the right was part of the water cycle, because we talked a lot about the water cycle. So this is cloud in a jar. You take really hot boiling water, put it in the bottom, the ice cubes on the top, and then it shows how condensation is formed on the glass. Loose parts inside and outside. So on the left is a little girl who goes outside all the time. She specifically went out and looked for these things when we were talking about insects, came in, showed what it looked like, took a picture. And on the right, it's a little girl who lives in a building and doesn't get out, but use loose parts to create insects in a variety of really cool ways. Also back to connecting it to literacy. So insects, what have we learned? So show me what you know. At the end of the week in literacy, kids were asked to show what are the things that you've learned this week about insects. And on the right-hand side, one of the STEM projects was to make a bug catcher. So this is a little boy in my class with his dad, and they had placed the bug catcher the day before. Now they're out investigating what bugs did they catch overnight and taking a look at them and really investigating what creatures live around their neighborhood. Insects, numeracy through honeycombs. So when we talked about insects, we kind of started to talk about bees. And we had been talking a little bit about geometry in math. So we connected that to a hexagon, and I showed them a real picture of a honeycomb and asked them to build their own. And I gave them the instructions that it was to be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and then to do the math with it. And then the second day they were asked to put bees into it with loose parts, however that looked. So one on the left, you'll see a little guy who did it with loose parts, and on the right is a little guy who was a little bit more cerebral, and he did it drawing it with actual numbers. Thank you.
Okay, so just before we move on to Chris, and I know insects would be a good theme for Chris as well to introduce his things, but thank you, Tisha. You've really given us a real breadth of what's possible with your theme, and I especially like how you've thought about the big ideas, because there's so much to teach. There, you could go anywhere, but really thinking about where you want to go and then mapping it backwards so that doesn't matter what the entry point is, they're all going to get to the right place at the end, understanding those big ideas. You've done that so well through those pictures. And thank you for being equitable and remembering where our kids are coming from, because not all kids will have all the resources and that others will. So making sure we're giving options. All right, so this brings us to Chris Grady. And Chris is at Oak Ridge. He teaches kindergarten outdoors, and he also does grade 3s and 4s in media. So Chris, over to you.
Hi, being equitable is a good place to start. I'm a sort of prep teacher with some other prep teachers at the school, and also a parent. So I'm aware that like my subject during sort of this whole pandemic maybe wouldn't be the most important. And as a parent, I know I've seen things come in from teachers that aren't my kids' main teachers, and I've sort of just ignored. So it's too much. It's overwhelming. So I've been working with the art teacher at my school, Jennifer Matsala, and we wanted to come up with sort of challenges or projects that kids, like all kids at our school could do, like that they would have the materials. And that it would be fun to do. So going in with the idea that this is something that is fun and not stressful, and it's not worried about grades and any of that, like this, that this should be an enjoyable experience. And, you know, my prep that I do is outdoor ed, so I knew that would be sort of challenging. And I wanted everyone to be safe and make sure that I wasn't pushing them outdoors when maybe it wasn't the right time. So I sort of created these videos. The first few were just about creating challenges. And then the last two, I sort of solicited ideas from the students. So you'll get the second video you'll see is has one of the students sent in a question that we sort of I incorporated into the video. So that's what we're doing more, is sort of just like you would in a kindy class, is you're building off the ideas that the students have, not just coming from the teacher. Yeah, so you can hit play again.
Why do birds suddenly appear every time you are near?
Hey, ever wish that you could fly, soar up high in the blue sky with the wind whipping through your hair? You know what I mean. Come. Fly with me over here. But why can't I fly? I'm a human. I'm smart. Just because I wasn't born with wings doesn't mean I can't. So why can't I fly? In order to find out this information, I went to one of the smartest people I know, my mom.
Well, you see, birds are meant for flight, and you're not. A bird's wings are shaped in such a way that allows air to push or lift them up. Birds also have strong muscles to move those large wings, and their bodies are lighter because they have bigger lungs that can fill up with more air. Birds also have hollow bones. So what I'm trying to say, sweetie, is that you're just too heavy to fly, and you're not strong enough.
Oh, I get it. I can't fly because I have big, heavy bones, and I'm not strong enough. Here's your challenge for today. Find some items around your house that you can build a scale out of, or something that can weigh an object. Check out the ones that I made. You can copy them, or you can try to make your own. Pretty excited to see what you're gonna make. If you do make something cool that can measure how much something weighs, make sure that you email it to me. Here's the email up here. Now have fun and be safe. I'll see you next time. Hi, Mom. What do you mean? I'm very strong. I'm strong.
Hey, yeah, you, over here. No, not there. Yeah, I know it's messy. What are you, my mother? Come, over here. Yeah, right there. Yeah, look inside now. You're probably wondering why I'm I'm inside this bin. Well, I'm trying to blend in or camouflage. It's a technique that creatures use to hide from predators and dangerous animals. And right now, I have a giant red-tailed hawk loose in the house. You see, red-tailed hawks are raptors. And like all raptors, they have excellent vision. They can see colors like humans can. But they can also see colors in the ultraviolet range. They can see colors that humans can't. The one benefit to being stuck in this bin, I've had time to read all the wonderful, amazing questions that students from Oak Ridge have been sending me. Like this one from Meta. She had a question about a different animal's eyes.
Hi, Mr. Grady. Elephants are the largest land animals. They have big ears, big trunk, big body, and big legs. But my question is, why do they have small eyes?
Great question, Medha. On average, an elephant's eyes are less than 4 centimeters, and their eyesight isn't that good. There's no way to know for sure, but scientists believe that an elephant's eyesight is so poor because it doesn't need it. An elephant relies mainly on its trunk and its hearing to get by. Some elephants that are blind have been able to lead their pack, and not being able to see doesn't impact that at all. Can you think of some other creatures that don't really need their eyesight to get by? Write your ideas and answers below in the comments. Oh no, don't sit down. Okay guys, challenge time. Pretend a giant creature's after you. See if you can blend in and camouflage in your home. Send your pictures to me at this email up here, and I'll see if I can find you. And don't forget to keep sending me those questions. They're great. Maybe your question will make it into the next video. All right. See you soon.
I think you're right, Chris. What you've done is you've made them so engaging that I want to do the challenges now. And that's what I remember doing a little bit of research on math, make math moments matter. And that's what they said too. I mean, worrying about the big ideas and that is our job, but to trying to make the lesson so engaging. And most of us are just giggling. Good thing our mics are off. So obviously go to the YouTube channel. And Chris, I have to tell you, after your date with the spider, I have now photocopied this beautiful yellow spider that's hanging out in my garden.
Chris, I'm interested in what kind of reactions you've had from your students.
It's been good. A lot of very positive feedback. And I haven't put them all up on the site, the oakridgecreates.com site yet, but lots of really wonderful submissions from students that generally we don't always hear from. So it's been really nice to see, yeah, like how excited they are to send stuff. They want to be part of it, right? And especially now that we're asking for questions from them, I'm getting a lot, which is nice, which is what you want.
And I don't want to turn anybody off of this, but how long does it take you to make each video?
It varies. Something like the spider one, which is a bit longer, but I would say it's a full day. So the last one we just watched is much shorter, and that probably took like 6 hours. The hardest part was figuring out how to fix like the couch cushion I ruined and things like that.
I was wondering how many objects in your home now has a slit in them from your face. Yeah.
6 or 7.
All right, let's go on to the other webinars to make sure that you know what's coming up. So supporting outdoor play and learning in schools, we're doing part one this Thursday at 1 p.m. And then we're doing part two on Monday, June 15th. Again, sign up for these so that we can send you a reminder and make sure that you get the resources. Catherine O'Brien, who did our keynote at one of our EcoSchools OISE conferences, is back for a webinar on sustainable happiness and teacher well-being. Great timing, again, right after all the stress of getting all our notes together for report cards. Hopefully this will be a good breath of fresh air. And then our normal pollinating partnerships, which we normally would have down at OISE in person to celebrate you, we're going to be having virtually. And that's why it's a little bit later in the day, again at 3 p.m., a chance to chat, a chance to celebrate, and catch up with your colleagues. So again, all the webinars you can register for at the EcoSchools link down below.
We'd also love to hear about your ideas about what you're doing in your classrooms. This is just a small handful of the amazing work that EcoSchools teachers in two boards. So we've got TDSB teachers and Jen's from York Region. I'm sure there's other teachers doing really fantastic stuff, and we'd love to hear about what you're doing.
We're also hoping to have more webinars in the fall about some of this great teaching that you're doing. So this is a great chance to kind of, like Cynthia did, you're doing amazing things. Just, you know, you may not realize it. Just be proud of yourself and let us know what you're doing so we can share the good news.